Everlasting to God Almighty. Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Shema, Jehovah Rohi, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Whoever you are, wherever you're watching us from, you're welcome to Beacon Life Church, Nairobi, Kenya. We are committed to shining Jesus' light as we advance the glorious gospel of the kingdom. Our services are on Sunday, 10 a.m. Power Thursday, which is also our midweek prayer service at 6 p.m. You're welcome to join our life groups, Beacon at Home, Beacon at Work. Don't you hesitate to get in touch with us for the details of the life group closest to you. Let's now celebrate the Lord with our generous giving. The M-Pesa pay bill number is 535471, and you can also give through PayPal by following the link on the website www.beaconlifechurch.org. For cash, checks and transfers, our bank details are displayed on the screen. Feel excited to join us on our social media handles to subscribe, like, comment and follow Beacon Life Church on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Thanks, Subanch, for joining us today. Welcome to Beacon Life Church. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the service.
A very good morning to all of our viewers, wherever this finds you. We are so very delighted that we are able to reach you in your home and wherever you may be, on your cell phone, on your tablet, on your computer, even on your TV. We are absolutely delighted, and we pray that this will be a blessing to you. I bless you, beseech you, in the name of the Lord, that you could take a moment and like us on Facebook, subscribe to our channel on YouTube, leave us a comment on Instagram, even on Twitter. We'll be so very glad to receive a little comment from you to know how what we are doing is impacting your life. Before we shoot through the word, I would like to just take a moment, as is my custom, to honor, love, and celebrate all of you that so graciously, abundantly, tenaciously, and so indefatigably give. You give of your resources, you give of your monies to make sure that what we are doing is sustained and continues to thrive and not only survive, even in this moment of very economic times that we are in. I want you to know that we celebrate so deeply you and your gifts, and I pray that the grace of God will abide on your seed so abundantly that, as the scripture says, God will bless your seed and it will come back to you a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I so do pray that men, women, organizations, institutions, even nations will pour back into your bosom as a mighty harvest promised from the Lord in the name of Jesus. Let's go to the scriptures this morning, and my text is going to be taken from Isaiah chapter number 42 and the verses number 3. A bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment unto truth. Three things demonstrated in that text. Number one, a bruised reed he will not break. Number two, a smoking flax he will not quench. But number three, he will bring forth judgment unto truth. I want to bring to you my little exegesis this morning, that I want to subject bruised but not broken. If you're writing notes, that will be good for you. Bruised but not broken. Let's pray together. Abba, Father, we thank you for the declaration of your word. We thank you for this wonderful ministry of the preaching and the teaching of your word. We thank you for the entrance of thy word giveth light and imparteth understanding to the simple. I pray, so proclaim and decree this morning, that light and enlightenment will come to our hearts, that the declaration of this word of exhortation shall be so very heavily settled in our hearts to transform us, change us, encourage us, renew us, set our feet in a sure place, and cause us to absolutely never ever be the same again. And if you believe with me, wherever you are, you might say amen. A bruised reed he shall not break, his smoking flax he will not quench, he shall bring forth judgment unto truth. The words used in that text, bruise, reed, break, smoking flax, quench, but he will bring forth judgment unto truth. We see that there is a reed and we see that there is a flax. We see that the reed is bruised and we see that the flax is smoking. The reed is bruised because so is the reed. The reed is known to be among the weakest of all and most despicable of all stock plants. I mean, a reed is weak by nature. It can be blown into brokenness even by the wind. You will not compare, you would not like to compare the reed with what we know about plants, for example, trees like the mighty oak. The oak stands tall and mighty in full strength and pride. On the other hand, the reed is weak and so feeble, like I said earlier, very despicable, that even a little bit more strength in the wind will cause a bruise on that reed. So much so that when you are walking by where the winds grow, you find many of them broken or literally bruised and bent in many directions. But the scriptures say here that a bruised reed he will not break. It is bruised because to bruise, the word to bruise is also the word means to crush and to be grievously oppressed. To crush and to be grievously oppressed. So we are looking at a reed that has been literally crushed and grievously oppressed by the forces of nature, by the forces of the wind, by the forces of the passerby who will try to pull a branch here and pull a piece of it here, try to prune it without permission. And so the forces of life have put the reed in such a place that it has been bruised. Bruised by the wind, bruised by the sun, bruised by the passerby, bruised by insects and animals. I mean, if a cow just passed by a reed, that might be the end of its existence. But I like what the prophet here says in chapter number 42 and verse number 3, that even though the reed is bruised, I'm so glad that it is not broken. And so that's why I say today we talk bruised but not broken. The flax is smoking, but he says he will not quench it. He will not quench it. A smoking flax, to smoke in terms of what a smoking flax would be, is to be dimly burning, to be dull, to be dark, colorless, or even faint. A smoking flax, for purposes of understanding language here, is like the wick you have in a little burning candle, a burning little paraffin lamp somewhere. And sometimes when we say that the flax is smoking, is that it's not burning as it should be burning. It's almost out of the burning power, but there is a little smoke that is still coming off of it, because deep in that wick is still a sense of heat, a sense of energy that could cause a manifestation of that heat or a fire to still burn forth. It's not completely gone out. And so that is demonstrated by the smoke that you see upon the wick. Therefore, the scripture that even a smoking flux, he will not quench. Rather than break the reed that is bruised, and rather than quench the flax that is smoking, the scripture said he will bring forth judgment unto truth. Glory, hallelujah. You may like to hear the Eugene Patterson rendition of that scripture, Isaiah 42 and 3. That's in the Message translation. He says he will not brush aside the bruised and the hurt, and he will not disregard the small and the insignificant, but he will steadily and firmly set things right. Glory, hallelujah. That is already bringing excitement into my soul, that the Lord has a commitment that even though you seem to be broken, he will not brush aside the bruised and the hurting. The bruised and the hurting. You remember we said that to bruise is to be crushed and to be grievously oppressed. Glory, hallelujah. But he will not bruise, he will not cast, or he will not brush aside the bruised and the hurt. He will not disregard the small and the insignificant, but he will steadily and firmly set things right. That brings to mind the text that says, despising on the days of small beginnings in the book of Job, for the end thereof shall mightily increase. Glory, hallelujah. I mean, these begin to speak to me, the bruised reed and the smoking flax. seems to me like the picture of many Christians, the two picture descriptions that we talked about in our introduction there are the similitudes of many Christians, tired Christians, bruised Christians, smoking Christians. I mean, the waves of life have bitten us in many ways, especially in the last 5 months when everything going on in the world has been going on. We have been tied up in our homes. We have lost our jobs. Many have lost their jobs. Many have had their salaries cut. Some people have never seen their relatives in a long, long, long time. And I mean, you live in fear every day, in the night, in your bed, when you wake up in the morning, when your feet touch the floor in your bedroom beside your bed. Your mind is already wondering whether you'll make it through the week, through the month, or even through the day. I want to bring a little encouragement to you today, this Sunday morning, and declare to you that the heart of God is certain, the heart of God is sure, the heart of God is so brilliantly abiding in the direction of your life that God has not given up on you, so you should not give up on yourself. God has not given up on your life, so you shouldn't give up on your life. In spite of the fact that you are bruised, God is still so committed to you, like that reed by the roadside, as the Bible declares, you will not be broken. You might be bruised for sure because of everything that we've gone through. The winds have blown so hard, the tossing of the tempest has been massive, but we must have the confidence in our heart that God is with us. And because God is with us, though bruised, we will not be broken. Though we seem to be smoking, we will not be quenched. Our life will not be quenched. Our energy to shine, Jesus' light, will not be quenched. Whether things seem to be turning around in our lives and the money has gone low and friends have gone low and you are alone and lonely many times by yourself in your house. You used to work in your office with all your colleagues. In the last 5 months, you've worked at home. If you have no children in your house, you wake up, look at your computer, you look at your tablet, and that has become your colleague. That has become your working space. Until you step out in the evening to catch a little sun, you can't even go beyond the gate of your estate lest you catch the virus somewhere. Be encouraged, my brother and sister, that in spite of this valley of the shadow of death that we could be walking through right now, as David declared so prophetically in Psalm 23, that I will fear no evil because I know that you are with me. I will say that in the words of Isaiah, though I may be bruised by my circumstances, I will not be broken. And though the flux is only but smoking, the life in me shall not be quenched in the mighty, glorious name of Jesus. In the Message translation, let's hear those words again. I will not brush aside the bruised and the hurting. In all your bruising and your hurting right now that you're not able to share with your BFFs or your best friends forever because you have no access to them anymore, may you be encouraged, my friend, that God will not brush aside the bruised and the hurting. He will not disregard the small and the insignificant. God has an agenda through the whole space that we are in, and it is prophesied by Isaiah that he will set judgment unto truth. He says in the Message, I will steadily and firmly set things right. May you catch that as a prophetic word in your life, that even right now when the stage looks dark, dim, and obtuse, ladies and gentlemen, God is about to open that curtain on the stage of your life one more time, and you will understand that through the circumstances and the trials of your life, God has been steadily and firmly setting things right. I want to say that it shall be well with you because God will make things right. I have a deep feeling in my soul that everything shall be all right because God is in charge, and it shall be so, not by might and not by power, but by the Holy Ghost of God that is at work in our lives. When I picture in my mind so graphically the existence of one bruised but not broken, of one still smoking but not quenched, of one still pushing to get to the crossing line of their race, of one still believing God in spite of the trials, in spite of the tribulation, in spite of the beating on the left and on the right, and 1,000 falling on your right and 10,000 on your left, and no evil coming in your tent, and God giving angels charge over you that even your foot will not be dashed against a stone. Whatever you your injury may be right now, whatever your trial may be right now, whatever your trying circumstances may be in your life, the good encouraging word I release to us today is that though bruised, you will not be broken. Though still smoking, the life in you will not be quenched. You are like what they call a superstar in an action movie. If you've looked at action movie stars, they are put in such a situation where they have to fight for their lives. And many times they are beaten and bruised. They have red eyes and broken noses and they are bleeding everywhere. Their legs are broken. Their clothes are torn. If you've watched some of all those old action movies, the guy will show up in the middle of a bust of a blasting of a bomb like a terrorist attack and his skin is black. If it is like First Blood of Sylvester Stallone, he will appear with a red band on his head and, you know, with a gun in his right hand, and it looks like he almost died, but ladies and gentlemen, he made it. If you've watched the Rocky of Sylvester Stallone, the same kind of script. If you've seen it by Mel Gibson of The Patriot, I mean, you see that guy showing up on the battlefield, bloody everywhere like a beast, and everybody dead and body parts around him, but he made it, bruised but not broken. I like The Fugitive. If you remember Harrison Ford, some of you may be too young to have watched a movie like that, but same script over there. He on the train and on the tracks and in the middle of nowhere, and he fights his way through to prove his innocence and fight for justice, and he still makes it, bruised and bleeding, clothes are torn and skin is black, and it looks like he almost died, but ladies and gentlemen, he made it. And that's what I'm trying to talk about you in your life. You better begin to look at yourself as the action superstar of the next movie of your life. As a matter of fact, your life story is a movie in itself, and I can picture your life, how you've gone through the gutters, how you've gone through the valleys, how you've walked through the waters, how sometimes you're almost completely given up on your life, and how the money went so dry that you thought you would not live another day, how at a certain season in your life the friends all left and you looked so friendless in spite of the fact that you had given so much into people's lives. I mean, your heart has been broken and broken again until you don't know what to present to who is going to be your husband sometime in your life. But the good news today is that the state is bruised, but it is not broken. I will say that again, that the state of your life could be bruised but not broken. I had a good scripture in the book of Job that declares that although the tree may be cut, but because the root of it is still in the ground, and I paraphrase the MD version, he says, at the scent of the water, that tree will sprout again. It has been cut, it has been bruised, it has been bruised, it has gone through trauma, it has gone through brokenness at many levels and many stages in their lives. Some of us have been abused and misused and broken, not just because of COVID, but so long time ago. I mean, your story started in kindergarten. You went through primary school as if you're already at university. I mean, everybody misused you and everybody broke your heart, spoke evil on you. I mean, they spat on you. They made you a doormat. I mean, they did evil to you. I mean, like story of Joseph at only 17, his own brothers that are supposed to be taking care of his life, they abuse him and misuse him so much that they leave him for dead. I mean, they didn't literally kill him, but every action they did was as good as dead. That when they went to their father, they brought his jacket of many colors and said, "See the blood of your son. Peradventure, a wild beast met him in the fields and crushed his bones and ate him up." Ladies and gentlemen, he was bruised in the pit. He was bruised in Potiphar's house. He was bruised in the prison. But guess what, ladies and gentlemen? He was never broken, because that story does not end until Joseph is in the palace. I say that story does not end until Joseph, the son of Jacob, is right next to Pharaoh as God. Governor in the greatest civilization of his time. The preacher would like to say today, you might be bruised, but you're not broken. You must not give up now, because you are not broken in spite of the fact that there is marks of bruise on your body. Let's go to the scriptures, Galatians chapter number 4. The Bible declares in verse number 13 and 14, these are the words of Paul as he writes to the church in Galatia. He says, you know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at first. I mean, the apostle here says, I preached the gospel through infirmity of the flesh. There was infirmity in my flesh and infirmity in my body, but I preached the gospel to you even at first. In other words, infirmity in my body would not stop me from the high calling of God on my life. Infirmity in my body would not stop me from what God has called me to do. The lack and the infirmity and the lack of this and the lack of that would not stop me. The bruising of my heart. I mean, people have spoken against you. Others have accused you falsely. Others have said things that do not even exist. Others have spoken their imagination so terribly on you that they have left you by their words and you have become as a shadow of your former self. My encouragement to you, ladies and gentlemen, is just like the Apostle Paul. Even with infirmity in your body, the gospel must be preached. Look at verse number 14. And my temptation which was in my flesh ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me even as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. He was received even as Christ Jesus because he continued to labor among them and declare the word and preach the gospel in spite of the infirmity and the temptation that was in his body and that which was in his flesh. They did not despise it or call him a sinner because of a certain infirmity. Sometimes our hearts are broken or because there is a certain infirmity in our lives. Somebody looked at you and said, you must be a terrible sinner. How can there be sickness in your body? You must be a fornicator. They look at you and say, how come you don't have any money today? You must be a sinner. Probably you don't give your tithe. Let me tell you something. Sometimes things happen in life and they just happen. And I would like to encourage everybody here to say, don't be so quick to judge and to bring condemnation upon other people's lives without really understanding the stories behind really their lives. I mean, you don't have to quickly find solutions and find conclusions of why people are living the way that, I mean, you don't have to be assistant Holy Spirit. You don't have to make yourself the fourth person of the Trinity. Sometimes you need to stand back a little bit so that your tongue will not be used as a weapon of injustice and condemnation upon the lives of the children of God. Because there is an infirmity in somebody's life, that does not give you a license to condemn them and send them for death, because apparently there must be sinners. I mean, the Bible declares that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And if it were not for the mercy and the grace of God that has presented the gift of Jesus, none of us would have crossed the line of mercy, the line of grace. The mercy, the Bible said that mercy triumphs over judgment, because the scale upon which is weighed is the scale of the grace of God that gives everybody a chance in spite of our weaknesses, our troubles, our tribulation, our infirmities, and our temptations. Glory, hallelujah. Somebody give me an amen on that. Hallelujah. Verse number 15, we are still in Galatians chapter number 4. The Bible says, where is then the blessedness you speak of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and have given them to me. I read this and I'm amazed, because it seemed to me like Paul is trying to say that he had a tragedy with his eyes. I wonder whether this is the infirmity that he talks about when he's writing to the Corinthians, and he says that for the greatness of the revelation that was given to me, there was put a thorn in the flesh, that I may not boast of myself, but that the glory may be of God. He says there is an infirmity in my body, a temptation in my flesh, and he says, you love me so much that if you could, you could have plucked out your own eyes out of the sockets in your head, in your skull, and given them to me. Meaning that the apostle is boldly declaring here that part of his tragedy in life, whatever the story may have been, we know him as a miracle worker. We know him as a miracle worker. He heals the sick. He cleanses the leper. I mean, he's walking around with James, with Peter and John. These are guys whose shadows are cleansing the lepers and raising the sick off of their sick bed. But the apostle is not ashamed to declare cleanly and unequivocally that there is a temptation, a trial, and an infirmity of his body. And it gives a little glimpse to what that could be when he says, you could have taken out your eyes and given them to me. In other words, my own eyes have a challenge. but still bruised but not broken. We don't know a man that has done great exploits for the church from its inception as a New Testament church like Saul of Tarsus that ultimately became Paul the apostle. But when you see his profile, you might think the man had no infirmity in his life. You might think the man had no bruise in his life. And I want to bring this wonderful, wonderful greatness of the good gospel to you, Evangelion, the good news to you, that in spite of the bruise in your body, God will still use you. In spite of your past, God will still work with you. In spite of the trials in your life, even right now, God can still work and will still work with you, because even though you are bruised, the good news in the heart of God is that you will not be broken. Let's hear the profile of Apostle Paul. I will skip to Galatians chapter number 6 and verse number 1. He says, brethren, if a man be overtaken by a fault, in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, and considering thyself, lest ye also be tempted. I mean, the apostle is trying to say, now, those of you that think you're big and you're righteous and you're all wonderful, holier than thou, you are the most holy thing that we know, south of the Sahara, north of the Limpopo. He says, be careful when you see a brother that has been overtaken in a fault, a brother that has been bruised, a sister that seems to be bleeding. He says, don't quickly judge them. He says, you that are spiritual, restore such an one in a spirit of meekness, considering yourself, lest yourself also be tempted. In other words, in meekness, I begin to restore those that are weak. What God is trying to say here through the Apostle Paul is that, because you see, meekness is strength under control. That I have every right to judge a man because he's a fornicator. I have a right to judge a man because he's been found in the bar drinking himself all night. I have every right as a Christian to speak ill over a man that drinks like a fish and smokes like a choo-choo train. But if I consider myself to be strong, then according to the wisdom of Paul, I must take time in meekness, take my strength under control, and begin to restore such a man in the spirit of meekness. Because God is going to use you and me as instruments of his grace to work restoration and revival in our families, in our churches, and among our peoples. Because the heart of God is to restore everyone that is caught in a fault. The heart of God is to restore everyone that seems to be broken. The heart of God is to restore everyone that seems to be bleeding. The story of the great Samaritan never goes off of my spirit when I say things like this. Because we can be the Levite and we can be the priest who walks away and does nothing right over the injustice that has been done upon this man. But the calling upon you and me, ladies and gentlemen, is that we will become the hand and the feet and the tongue and the voice and the eyes of God, to put our hands in the dirt and be able to bring some help upon a brother that seems to be hurting, broken, or caught up in a fold, so that Isaiah 42 and 3 may be right in their own lives, that even though they are only smoking, their light will not be quenched. Even though they are only but bruised, yet they will not be broken. Galatians 6 and 1. Let's skip a few verses there and go to Galatians 6 and verse number 17. He says in verse number 17 there, From henceforth, let no man trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. I will read that again. I would like that to sink in your spirit so deeply with conviction in your spirit. He says, from henceforth, let no man trouble me. I mean, don't trouble me by your injustice, and don't trouble me by your lewd thinking and your evil presentations about my own life. Don't trouble me. He said, do not trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this is a very powerful, powerful exhortation here by the Apostle Paul, that in my own body, I bear the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. I've been through some places, the apostle is saying, where my skin has been cut. I've been stoned, and thrice I've been left for dead. I've been put through out of the city wall in a basket. I've lived in the deserts of Arabia, probably about 3 or even more years. I've been, my life has gone through some trials and temptation, that in my body, I have the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. So don't look at me and trouble me by your own unfaithful imaginations or wonderings about life. Don't look at a man because of the way they look and how they dress and how they talk and imagine some things about them and begin to create castles in the air over their lives and begin to trouble their lives by drawing them in a direction here and another direction there. Paul said, trouble me not, for this one reason, that in my body I bear the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. May I encourage somebody today and say that everything that you're going through that has left you bruised and heartbroken, it is the mark of the Lord Jesus Christ in your body. They left you crying, but what the devil intended for evil, God has turned it to work for good. It has become like the stones on the jacket of a major general that says, I was in the battle of such and such a place. I was in the war of such and such a place. It has become like a words in your office that says you were in Afghanistan in the year 1994. You were in Kandahar in the year 2000. And you went through Corona in the year 2020. I mean, you've gone through rejections of life. You've gone through mudslinging in your life. You've gone through backstabbings in your life. All those have become as marks in your body of our Lord Jesus Christ. If you meet Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, there is something about their skin and their hair that looks different from everybody else because they have walked through the fire. Trouble me not, my brother, my sister, for in my body I bear even the marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You have done business that left you so broken and old money conned and taken that you could have died. It's 7 years later and you are still alive. That business did not sink because God still has a plan. God still has a wonder-working, marvelous plan for your very own life. Let's look at the profile that leaves him with marks in his body. The scripture is going to be 2 Corinthians chapter number 4. I will read verse number 7 through to verse number 10. And it says in verse number 7, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of our Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus may be made manifest in our own body. Can you imagine if that were the profile of your life? I mean, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power might be of God. I mean, my body may not be all perfect, and the way I live may not be all perfect. I may not be your super angel Michael or Gabriel or Raphael. I'm only but Dennis Desire, living here in Nairobi, Kenya, walking on shoe leather, driving Toyota like everybody in the city. He said, but we have this treasure in the earthen vessel, in a normal, nominal life, that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of us. Look at verse number 8. We are troubled on every side, but not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of our Lord Jesus Christ, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our own body. Ladies and gentlemen, whatever you are going through, troubled on every side, be you will not be distressed. Perplexed every day, but not in despair. Persecuted even for your faith, but God will never forsake you. You may seem cast down a little now, but you will not be destroyed, because in your body you bear the marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because you might be bruised, but I came to tell you, you will not be broken. That's the journey of all great men. That's the path of greatness. I mean, you never see a great man that has no story to tell, that has no scars in their lives, because the scars that you have picked on your journey will will become the stars that will shine around the throne of your greatness, because every great man must walk through that valley, the valley of stones and sharp rocks that are going to leave marks on every side of your body, in the making of a man that God will trust with his power, with his anointing, with his grace, with his might, that we may be able to say like Apostle Paul, we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. I cannot bring this to an end without talking about Jesus, our high priest. And yet if I talk about Jesus, time will fail us, as the writer of Hebrews declares. But in a nutshell, ladies and gentlemen, Jesus has been the greatest action movie hero that we could ever know. I mean, he's told the story of life capsuled all together. The Bible says he was the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world, walked through all history. At some point, Paul says he was the rock that walked with the children of Israel through the wilderness. 40 years. He calls him many names with many manifestations to different people at different times. Glory to God. At one point in the wilderness, he was as a serpent that was raised, the bronze serpent that was raised upon that tree in the wilderness, that whosoever looked at him then may be made whole, as a demonstration that he would carry the sin of the whole world and become as evil as a serpent, so that the judgment of God may be able to come upon that serpent, that present serpent, a representation of Jesus that would be raised on another hill called Calvary. Calvary in the Greek, Golgotha the hill, so that upon that hill he may be able to take the wrath of God as if he was a serpent, that he may cry and say, my Father, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That in the justice of humanity, that in the justice of the sin of humanity, Abba Father would forsake his only begotten son, that he may be bruised even to the point of death, but he's still the hero of all times. Because you know as well as I know that when he said it is finished, he gave up the ghost. Joseph of Arimathea went and picked his body after permission is taken from Pilate the governor. But the Bible declares when he was put in that borrowed tomb on the third day, Sunday morning it was, an angel stood by that day, the opening of that cave, and when Mary and others came by, he was not there, ladies and gentlemen, because he kicked the bottom out of the grave. He rose triumphant, bathing a church out of his side, where he was pierced that his blood may be able to flow. I can see him pierced in the side, bruised on the head because of the crown of thorns that he bore. I mean, he was beaten and spat on, he was despised, he was beaten that to the point that he was transfigured beyond recognition. But ladies and gentlemen, he was not broken, because the Bible is very clear. I mean, read Isaiah 53 and you will see the whole story that I try to unravel for you right now. The justice of sin was laid on his body. He said in 1 Peter 2 and 24 that he took our sin on his body on the tree, that we may die to sin and live unto righteousness, and that by his stripes we have been healed. Ladies and gentlemen, we are healed because he has marks in his body. Nails went through his hands because he has marks in his body. We rejoice and triumph in the victory that he has brought to us because there are marks in his body. May I say, ladies and gentlemen, just like Jesus has marks in his body, those of us that are Christians, those of us that believe in him, those of us that walk with him, those of us that trust in him, a servant is not greater than his master. Every now and then there are going to be marks in your body. Every now and then there's going to be marks on your spirit. Every now and then there's going to be marks on your soul. But though bruised, you will not be broken, because our master was bruised beyond recognition, and yet 3 days later he came bouncing with victory. I mean, the Bible say he showed himself unto the disciples after his passion with infallible proof for 40 days. After that, he told them to go and wait in Jerusalem until they be endued with power. He said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given unto me. Therefore, go ye around the world, preach the gospel, discipling nations and teaching them the things that I've commanded you, because they are marks in my body. It is like there is a seal on the ministry of the gospel. gospel. There is a seal on the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. There is a seal on our lives. According to the book of Ephesians, is the seal of the Holy Ghost. But in your own physical life, there's going to be a revelation of marks and scars in your own body as marks of our Lord Jesus Christ. He says, if a man will not carry his own cross and follow me, he's not worth to be my disciple. Meaning that carrying your cross is like the way he walked out of the city to go be crucified, that marks may be left on his body. Remember, they are marks because they will leave you bruised but not broken. It is that same Jesus Christ that healed the sick. He cleansed the lepers. He brought hope to prostitutes. He turned tax collectors into apostles. He turned madmen like the madman of Gadara into preachers. The Samaritan woman became a preacher that he met by the well. I mean, fishermen, he turned them into fishers of men. I mean, time would fail us to tell the stories of Jesus, but you know as well as I know that he even raised the dead, because the demonstration of the heart of God is always committed to reach out to those that are broken, those that are sick, those that are lepers, those that are governed by sin, those that are overwhelmed by the systems of their world like tax collectors, those that are mad, oppressed and obsessed, and overwhelmed, possessed and oppressed. I mean, fishermen, I mean, it turns their business life completely and gives them a new career path where they'll become fishers of men rather than fishers of men. He says, follow me and I will make you. Ladies and gentlemen, the making of our Lord Jesus Christ will leave us with marks in our bodies, which may be demonstrated by a bruising in your life here and there. Don't you confuse the bruise for brokenness, because when it is all done, God is going to do a great and quick work in your life. God is going to do a majestic work in your life. God is going to do a marvelous work in your life. He's not only going to do a work in your life, but he's going to use you to do a marvelous work in your generation and for the people that are in your life, because the marks in your body are marks of the walk that you walk with Christ Jesus. Bruised, but not broken. Let's wind it out as we talk about Apostle Paul one more time. He says in 2 Corinthians 12, and I elucidated on this a little earlier. He says in verse number 7, 2 Corinthians chapter number 12. He said, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me. He said, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. Verse number 9. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Glorious God Almighty. What on earth would God have to do with weakness in my life? He says, for in your weakness, my strength is made perfect. Isn't it interesting that Paul says, I actually prayed 3 times. Now, I don't want to be prophetic here, but as I preach to you, I know that there are things you've been praying for in your life. You have prayed thrice. You have prayed 7 times. You have prayed 12 times. You have fasted since last year that a certain thing be broken. It looks like a reproach in your life. And your prayer has been, I think I'm prophesying, Lord, roll away the reproach. And you're saying, Lord, why is that reproach still with me here? Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, the reproach is about to be rolled away. But before you see the reproach gone, he says, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. God is perfecting strength in the weakness that seems to be happening in your life right now. And what was a reproach is about to become a scar. What seemed as a reproach is about to become a mark of Jesus Christ in your own body. That when you stand the next time to testify and tell of the story of the goodness in your life, you will be able to say, I was bruised but never broken. I was bruised but I survived. I did not only survived but have thrived to prevail, that I will not die but live to tell of the goodness of God in the land of the living. Ladies and gentlemen, my grace, the Lord says, is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. In other words, don't be afraid of weakness. Don't be afraid of weakness. Don't be afraid of what looks like a temptation right now, because the Lord will lift you up with power. The Lord will lift you up and brag around you like Job, with marks of the Lord Jesus Christ
in your body, God will be telling your story, saying, have you considered my servant Job? Have you considered my son? I mean, what I'm telling you here today is going to elevate you to such a space that God will in his conversation, he will consider you his servant that deserves a visitation. Oh, hallelujah. My strength is made, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Let's finish that text. He says, most gladly, therefore, I will rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecution, in distress, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. May that be the story of your life, my good brother and sister. Hallelujah. May that be the story of your life. He says, therefore, I gladly rejoice. I most gladly, therefore, will rather glory in my infirmities. Can you imagine that that thing that you're going through, like this corona season we are going through right now, according to the words of Paul, he says, we can actually grow glory, and we would rather glory in the infirmities that the power of Christ may rest on me. If the power of Christ is going to rest upon you in this season, you better find your glory in the infirmities you see right now, because God is about to turn them around for your good. He says, the power of Christ will rest on me. Therefore, I take pleasure, not just in a new house, in a new car, in a new job, in good health, and a wonderful story. I also take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distress, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. What Paul is saying here, that when you think you are really strong, then you are not strong, because your strength is demonstrated in weakness. So your real strength is when you're weak. If you've had a sleepless night because you're thinking about what's going on in your life, God is considering you strong. Because if you're not strong, you will never have made it through it. God is looking at you as strong to be able to go through that fire. Because if you're weak, you would never made it through the fire. The writer of Proverbs says, if you're weak in a crisis, you are weak indeed. Because in spite of the crisis, God considers you to be strong. You are not strong when you are strong. You are actually strong when you are weak. Because you will be able to come out of that weakness and demonstrate the power of God that has come upon your life in spite of the infirmity. Let's take it home, ladies and gentlemen. Isaiah 42 and 3, as we said, he will not brush aside the bruised. He will not brush aside the bruised and the hurt. He will not disregard the small and insignificant, but he will steadily and firmly set things right. If you've had anything that I say here today, God will steadily and firmly set and make things right in your life. He's a master chess player and is about to make a move in your life. You will lift your hands and say checkmate, because you didn't see it coming, but God was playing behind your hands. He's about to blow a wind of the Holy Ghost in your direction, that everything that seemed like a valley of dead bones is going to come again alive. Every bone to its bone, every sinew to its sinew, and your life will become a mighty army of the demonstration of the power of God in your generation. When you are weak, you are strong, and you must celebrate where you are right now in spite of the challenge, because God says he will not brush aside the bruised and the hurt, because a bruised reed will not break. He will not disregard the small and the insignificant, because a smoking flax he will not quench. But listen to this, he will steadily and firmly set things right in your life to the glory of God, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. That's why the treasure is in an earthen vessel. You may be bruised, but you will never be broken. Lift your hands and give God the praise. Oh, hallelujah. Wherever you are, why don't you stretch your hands as we take a moment to pray, declaring the grace of God on your life in spite of the weakness. I prophesy by the power of God that your bruise will not cause you to be broken. I speak to everyone discouraged that you will not be discouraged anymore. I speak to everyone that seems broken and dying that you will live and not die. I speak to those that are carrying the coronavirus right now. If you hear the sounding of my voice, I command that you are healed, and so shall you be in the mighty name of Jesus. I speak to those that have lost their jobs, have had their salaries cut, in the mighty name of Jesus. God shall supply for all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Jesus, by the power of God. I speak to those that seem to be having symptoms in their body right now, and they can't sleep at night because they think they're going to receive good news, bad news. I decree in Jesus' name, you will not be afraid of bad news, for your heart is fixed, trusting the Lord. I declare even right now in Jesus' name that God is working in your life, and he will steadily and firmly bring everything that is disorganized to order in your life. I prophesy, may the valleys be exalted. May the exalted mountains be brought low. May the crooked parts be made straight. May light shine wherever there has been darkness. I decree by the power of God upon your life, everything wrong be made right. And I command that the rest of your life shall be even the best of your life. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, to hold you up and sustain you in truth and in holiness by the power of God, even unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And to him be glory today and forever. May his hand rest upon you like it was upon Jabez, that he will extend your territory and do you good and give you peace and cause you to be noble among your brethren. I speak that grace on you, that his hand will be upon you, and he will keep you from evil. Your story will be good and not bad. You will live and not die. Your hands will be lifted and not slack. Your feet will be set in a sure place. If you believe and you receive, say a mighty amen to the glory of God. From the very bottom of my heart, I pass the love from Beacon Life Church here. We love you. We celebrate and honor you. I look forward to one of these days when I will cast my eyes on you face to face as we give God the glory together. Dr. M.D. Desire, Beacon Life Church, Nairobi, Kenya. God bless you all.